Okay, are we on? Okay, well, welcome our video audience. These are all on YouTube. I don't know if anybody watches them, but they're on here. Okay, so I said we have a good show for you tonight. We're going to talk about, this was on the board last week, but we didn't get a chance to talk about it, which was the iron cow gives birth to a calf on a 100-foot pole, which is the famous Zen koan. Take that home and figure it out. I've just noticed something in meditation when I was running the race. I think I've said this before, but this is, this really contains the whole practice of the Dharma in this, because here you have the pairs of opposites of the world, but they're joined. So it's not like if this were good, it would be way over there, and this was bad, it would be over there, they're separate. So if this is good and bad, up, down, in, out, they're really mutually dependent. And they don't make any noise without each other, right? No noise. Right? So if you're just trying to make noise with the good, like that, or with the bad. So if you want to be a good person, that's the noise you make. If you want to be a rebel, that's the noise you make. If you put them together, see, and that's the Big Bang. In philosophy, yoga, East India, that sound is oh. In the Bible, it's called the Word. First there was the Word. First there was Om. And Om contains, it contains all the sounds that both people can make. All the vowels, and then silence. So it contains all the sounds, and then sounds at this point. So when you ring these, goes to that. So this contains all the sounds, and so it's surrounded by sounds. In the same way that the light switch, on, off, we talked about that, the on, off, is held by the room. And the room is neither on or off. The room contains on, off. So in our conscious minds, we run around trying to find on and not being off, trying to get good and not getting bad. And we stay in this room here, we're trying to separate the pairs of opposites. In order so we can get something good or avoid something bad. So we're either running after the good or running from the bad. And they're the same. So that is Satori. When you see the pair of opposites in a particular situation that we're hung up in, like the hung up we were talking about there, well, is something wrong with me, is something wrong with the sofa, why did they call back, you know, is there something with it, you know, all that problem, you see, that's a pair of opposites between my expectation of what should be and what is, and they're not matching. So this is my expectation of what should be, they should be calling back and getting on the ball, and this is what I'm getting. I don't want this, I want this, I want my expectation, and I want what I'm getting. So something's wrong. I got to find out. Because it causes tension and suffering. And this is what Buddha called in the First Noble Truth, life is suffering, is that tension between the, I want things to be this way, but it isn't. So now I see, I want things to be this way, but this is the way it is. I want my husband to be this way, but this is what I got. See, so I want I want to get the world to fit my expectations of what the world should be. But it will never do that, so that creates a tension that we kick down the road trying to get an answer that you can't get. Because the world will never fit their expectations, because their expectations are just a thought, an idea. And the world will not fit into an idea in more than a letter is going to fit into a postage stamp. So that idea is an abstraction of reality, so the reality can't fit into the abstraction. We got all hung up with that. So anyway, I just thought I would share just, you know, some insights on what's really going on with these things, because it's more, you know, it becomes a really nice physical metaphor for the Big Bang Theory. And Sheldon, this is Sheldon's spot. Okay, like I said, we have a big show today. I wrote this during the week, and I thought I would pass it out just so you could keep it, so if you could refer back to the talk on it. It's called The Tale of the Cast Iron Griddle. It fits into this coin up here. So it's, is that two or one? I think that's two. So we could replace, as we go along, I could replace the cast iron cow with the griddle. And we'll leave this for fill in the blank. Okay, just to give a little outline of the iron cow gives birth to a calf on a 100-foot pole. The 100-foot pole would be a pole that you were climbing up, maybe to get to heaven or to the good or something, and you would come to 100 feet and there it would end. And you can't go back down and you can't go up. So that you're stuck. That's the iron ball in the throat. I can't cough it up, can't swallow. Can't figure out if these people are crazy, they don't like me, what's going on. You know, I'm stuck with that. I can't figure out why. So then you have an iron cow on top of this 100-foot pole. So when you get to the 100-foot pole, there's going to be an iron cow, which is the cone. So, and you know, your teacher says, or you know in your heart, that this situation is going to give birth to something if I could just figure out the key to make it happen. So this is the puzzle. How do you make the iron cow give birth to a calf? How do you make the sofa company give birth to an insight? So the calf, in that sense, would be an insight that liberates me from a particular stuckness in my life, which we could call the enigma. Did y'all see that? I really go back to this movie a lot, The Imitation Game. Mm. I recommend you see it. Have you? You saw it in the movie. I recommend you see it if you watch movies, but it's about the Robert Turner, Englishman, who in the Second World War was a mathematician, oddball, genius, and they were trying to figure out the German enigma machine that was communicating from Germany to the U-boats and telling the U-boats where to go to sink the ships. And they couldn't figure out how this code, every U-boat had an enigma machine. And it was had so many variables in it that it would take the code breakers a long time to figure out what the variables were, but but the machine reset every 24 hours. So they might work for 24 hours, and then it would reset, and you'd have to start from scratch. They couldn't do it. It's humanly impossible to figure out the code of the Enigma machine. Well, Turner built a thinking machine, which was the first computer, that could think fast enough to figure out the variables, the combinations, before the thing reset. But it was still spinning. The thinking machine could not, thinking, it couldn't stop thinking, it couldn't come up with the snap that would stop the, that would get the solution, that would break the code. And one of the, while they were in a bar, they'd given up everything and they were just drinking. Can't, you know, the whole thing's a failure. It's not going to work. Somebody said, you know, they every time they send a message, they sign it in, some clerk noticed something about the German messages. He says, every time they sign...
A female clerk.
Yeah, so every time they sign, every time they send anything, they say, Heil Hitler. And immediately a light went off on Turning and they went running out of the room to the machine. They had, they found a constant that was going to be on all the codes, Heil Hitler. And with that one constant, it was like if you have a compass and you want it to run around and make marks, one leg has to be constant. You can't find anything if both legs are running around. You got to stick one in the ground. So they stuck it in the Heil Hitler. And it was running, and snap, the machine stopped, and it read the code, the message. So the thinking machine is our minds are thinking machines in the sense that we really think. And but there's a code that we can't get. But are we? The question is, are we just a thinking machine? Am I a machine? You see, and this was part of the thing of the movie. Turner was also gay, and at that time, so homosexual, at that time he was being prosecuted in England. So he got prosecuted after the war for being homosexual. Even though he had saved the war, they still prosecuted him, and I don't know if they put him in jail or fined him or what, but he committed suicide. Just recently, I think they honored him. He was the father of computers. So he built the first thinking machine to solve the enigma of the thinking machine. But one of the questions was that he asked, particularly when he was being interrogated by the policeman who was trying to get something on him. Are you a machine? You would ask him, are you a thinking machine? But the whole point of, as I look at this movie and revisit it, it's called The Imitation Game. So what is the imitation game, but it's the thinking machine's game of real life. So we are, when we're born, you see, we're the little child is indoctrinated by culture, parents, language, this separates, this gets separated, you do good, you don't do bad, right? All the values of our society and all that, it's all good, but we begin to think. And our society tells us, conditions us to believe that our thoughts are real. So my idea about the marker is what's real and not the actual marker. And I don't know what this actual marker is, because all I really know is the label I put on it. So Groucho Marx might think it was a cigar. You know, or you might find another use for it, like MacGyver would, which would not be, well, that's a marker, you can't use that for that. So we're all kind of like conditioned to be very factual and just believe the facts. The fact is that we're taught, you know, that poodle poop is dirty, so don't pick it up with your hands. Right? But it's just a soft brown texture. You know, it's not poop. Poop is what I put on it. It's just, it could be a piece of candy. It might look the same. might be a cigar butt. Right? You know, you see what I mean? You know, the poop is added. Now it's bad. You see? So the thinking machine is a dual machine. This is probably not on the video. So the thinking machine thinks in digits, just like computers. Right? So two digits could create the whole computer language. I don't want to think about this. I think it's 1. I don't know what it is.
0, 1.
Okay, so that's it. The whole world is built on 0, 1 that we're living in now. Isn't that interesting? Everything, all the computers, the global internet, the whole thing is built on that, you see. 0, 1. Nothing and something. A donut. Nothing and something. But we believe we eat the donut, we eat the something. The nothing's no good. Seinfeld made a skit on this. They were trying to sell donut holes. I don't know what's the, or say, what happened to the pizza, the centers? So they got something, they were selling donut holes, which was a biscuit. So you see what's going on here? So the donut, this is a duality here, right? Nothing and something, and that makes the donut. That makes the bells go bing, oh yummy, donut. But we have no value in the center. We don't eat the center. But we don't realize in the thinking machine that the center is the most valuable part. See, when the cup, there's the outside of the cup and the inside of the cup. The inside holds the stuff we drink. We don't drink the outside of the cup, but you only see the outside of the cup. The inside is empty. So our thinking machine, because it thinks in digits, can only see, we can only think about something. You can't think about nothing unless you say nothing, and then I'm thinking about nothing. That's a word. See? So if I say nothing, and I think about that, well, what I'm thinking about is the sound nothing. I'm not thinking about nothing because there's nothing there. The thought is something. So something can't think about nothing, you see, without giving up. It's something. So this is the enigma of the dual thinking machine, which is us. And this is not like something you should believe. This is something you should look at in your everyday life and watch the thinking machine go. Now here's the question. If you watch the thinking machine, who is looking? The donut hole. The donut hole, that's an eye, is seeing. Or awareness. And in Zen, when that eye opens up, it's Satori, or aha, I see. donut doesn't see. Nothing sees. But we're conditioned to believe, we're conditioned by our culture to believe we are something. I'm a me. Got a history, personality, relationships, family, country, gender, physical body, all makes me. And then all that memory is my placemat. So if you try to change your placemat in a family is going to get back in place. You sit there, right? You don't sit there. Or if you're gone, where did you go? Attention. So this has a lot of ramifications. Anyway, so let me get back to cast iron griddle. So anyway, I want to share. And this is what I do in this class, because like I said before, I mean, this really is, and I hope for you too, hump day. It's Wednesday, and hump day means hump day. And you, and this is the way I do it. And I don't know. This is what it feels like.
They don't occur.
This is what it feels like. The hump day is that during the week things happen in my life. I make insights. Something happens, and then I share them on hump day, and then I slide off again. Ooh. Go and have a martini. then the week begins again, and I have insights, discoveries, and then I come share them, and then I slide off and have a martini, and so forth. So anyway, last couple of weeks I've been having a lot of insights into my own enigma machine. Everyone here is married or has a partner, and you two don't. You're the two monastics.
I know.
You're the monastic too?
Yeah.
Okay, so three monastics, and you guys got a partner. Anyway. Well, this is monastics and households. both valuable paths, but each offers different discoveries. So if you're living with a wife, like I am, well then the relationship becomes a source for discovery. If you're monastic, well then your everyday situations become provide the coins and the gemstones for your satori and your insights, okay? Or the story of your life. Right now I'm writing, and I'm really discovering that it's really been a surprising thing. And I think it's a product of what's been happening in this couple of weeks. But I started writing, I named it, it's my personal story. And the problem when you're 78, you have a lot of story. So I call it the Buddha in the trash can. Okay, so I just started writing my story back from when I was in, my father was military in the Second World War, we moved a lot, so there was a lot of moving and turmoil, and loss of father, didn't know who he was, and he didn't know who I was, you know, all that stuff. So there was a lot of putting it in chapters, and just going through it, and I'm discovering several things. It's creating a lot of energy. The other day I started writing at 6:30 and didn't stop until martini time at 5 o'clock. So it was right around. And it was generating energy. And the reason it was generating energy, I see as I do this, is because two things are coming together. The personal and the impersonal. These are contradictory. We consider them to be opposites. Impersonal is, you don't give a crap about me. And personal is, well, I matter. You see? Impersonal is, you don't matter. Personal, I do matter. this is going on in our society, but, you know, Black Lives Matter as a person. The racist cop, you don't matter. In person. So, writing the story, I discovered that the bell was going off because I'm writing about my personal story and memories, some of which are emotional. I find emotions coming up. Yet at the same time, I'm objectively writing about it. I'm impersonally writing about it. So I'm impersonal about my personal. See? I'm finding it to be very cathartic in that. And it's generating energy. And but everything fits in context in our life. Nothing happens by itself. Everything is interrelated. So this story I'm writing, The Buddha in the Trash Can, is also interrelated to other stuff that's been happening in my life, which affects my marriage and your life as whole, so everything affects everything. It's a mistake to think, well, this will just affect me here and it won't touch me over here. So it's all one whole. But we like to split it apart and say, well, I'm at work now, but it's not going to help me. You know, home, you know, whatever, home and different here and there. So it's all one. So, one of the recurring enigmas in my imitation game of the thinking machine, which is me, in my marriage, has been a compulsion to throw something that was valuable to somebody else out. So if this were maybe had about that much water in it, and it were left on the table on the buffet or something, and maybe for a couple of days, I would come by and see it was impersonal, there's no value. Poop, poop. Then my wife would say, where's my water? Okay. Now in my enigma, here's what would happen. I would have absolutely no remembrance of whether I threw the water out or not. So, the consequence of that is that, am I guilty of throwing the water out? Because she was, where's my water? Right? Well, take that, you know. It's not like it was just water, I don't care. It was, where's my water? Now remember, this is a marital habit. And marriages are held together by little games we play. So what we're doing here is I'm using my little game, and it's a little cotton ball we're going to pull it apart so we can see how the thinking machine works. So you can perhaps get some insight into your beliefs, past or present. So the situation here is that you've got a relationship. This is a relationship, me, my wife, right? There's two things going on. First of all, we're separate individuals. You're in a relationship, and this doesn't mean well, so much marriage, it could be a friend, it could be, you know, any relationship, daughter, right? Any relationship. As soon as you get a relationship, you get this. If you're just walking down the street and you see somebody, there's no relationship. That goes that way, you go this way. In a relationship, you get this. Now, they're separate, but they're also one. And they don't make any music unless they hit each other. So a relationship is always making music. Now, is the music joyous, or is it painful? Same dynamics. How do we experience it? Little minor irritations continually, or a joy, or a creative relationship. See, joyous relationship doesn't necessarily mean, oh, I'm so joyous. It just means it's productive. It creates babies, creates art, creates peace, creates help for other people. Same relationship may create irritants, pain, ill health, physical symptoms, neurosis, anxiety, no friends, nobody wants to come to your house, you know, when it gets to extremes, we all know, you know, people who are dysfunctional. So what we're looking at here, basically, what are the laws of this enigma? Buddha called it, in the when he left the pleasure palace and went out into, he left his safe refuge and went out into the real world, and he saw existentially old age, sickness, and death. Well, this really is a kind of a metaphor. It's not really old age and sickness, because we all get, he wanted to end it. But he wasn't talking about physical getting old and getting sick and dying, because that happens. He's talking about the suffering that we add to old age, sickness, and death. And then he said, in his other teaching, and then he said that the suffering of the first noble truth, there is suffering, has laws. Laws. Operational laws. If you know the law of something, you know how it works. If you get a car or a sewing machine and it breaks, you get the manual and read the laws. Well, this works here and that works there. It's all laid out, and then you can fix the appliance because you know the law. If there's a flaw in the law, then you can't fix it. Okay. So anyway, just a little diversion here. So I'm connecting this back up to Buddha. The basic Buddhism is that Buddha said then there are, his whole teaching is to discover the laws of suffering, or the laws of the enigma machine, or a thinking machine, and how this thinking machine works. And the only thing that can see how the thinking machine works is the hole in the donut. If that hole is seeing, then that hole can look at the donut and see the donut objectively. But if that hole is not open, then me, or I, is inside the donut. So if the eye is not open, my personality, my me that gets hurt or wants stuff, the me is inside the machine as a thought, among other thoughts, but it is a big thought called the I thought. Right? So in the thinking machine, there is an I thought. That's me, and the me is held together by my memory and history and family and the placemats and all of my world and everything. So that's how it gets. But I really believe that I thought, that me, exists. So anyway, the practice here of Dharma is to understand the operational laws of the thinking machine, which can only be seen from insight, which comes from the donut hole, which is stillness. So see this, the donut, if you look at this as the mind, and it's a donut, the donut is movement, is thinking. Thinking is always going on. Right? The donut hole is still. The thinking can't go there, because thinking is movement. So movement can't go to stillness without shutting up. And thinking is not going to stop, because Because if thinking stops, the I thought, which is thinking, it says, I'm going to die. Right? So I watched this happen. It was 1980, and I was in meditation at Swami Muktananda's ashram in Miami. And I was getting ready to leave, and it was noon. I was sitting there chanting, sitting there. And my thinking, I thought, appeared in my mind like a little worm, or a moth. And it was sitting right there, and it said, I'm going to die. And this awareness, the donut hole, opened up as just awareness. And the little eye, thinking eye, blew right up into it. And then it came back down like a moth might come down after it hit the flame, all burnt. And it said, oh, that's what death is like. See, but the point is that the thinking I, and this is what I was talking about in the toilet sanctuary from last week, when I saw the I thought here, I'm just, you know, standing there, you know, and the I thought appeared, and it said, why isn't my wife cleaning the toilet? When I was looking at this dude. Why didn't she clean the toilet? But that was, the awareness was seeing that thought. Okay? And the awareness did not identify with it, because if it identifies with it, then you say, God damn it, she never cleans the damn toilet, you know, and I do all the work around here, and why isn't she going, I got to tell her to get on the stick. You know, because I feel like I'm a victim here. I'm the man. I should not be cleaning the house, you know. And she could at least clean the damn toilet. You know, it's right there, dirty. I mean, she's sitting on it, and using, you know, and all along, long ago. And the next thing you know, you got a big fight, you know. And she says, well, I do this. You know, you don't do that, you know. And I said, well, I do this and that. And next thing you know, get divorced. You can't. Over a toilet. So, you know, because it keeps expanding. You drop a little rock in the pond, and the next thing you know, ripples keep going out and out and out, you know, and it keeps coming up again because you haven't healed it. So the next time, there it is again, but it's bigger. You know, and then it's, there it is again, but it's bigger. And this can happen by ourselves as well as, you know, in relationship. So what we're looking at here, I don't know what we're looking at here. Getting back to my enigma of my Hawthorne Scarlet Letter.
Oh yeah.
So our sin gets hung around our necks in families, or in public, YouTube, or, I mean, on the news or whatever, and it won't let you go. So even though I have put out great effort not to, for instance, like my job is to clean up, and my wife cooks and I clean. So in order to avoid having trivial conversation with people, at dinner I'll clean up. So I'll take the plate, you know, whatever. In the past, I have taken a plate up that still had some food on it, right? It didn't look like it. It looked like they were done again. Hey, wait a minute, I wasn't finished. So I developed a reputation, see, for throwing stuff out. And that gets hung around your neck. So even now, even though I've tried really to be sensitive to and ask, whatever, I have a sister-in-law. And I'll get ready to go in the kitchen, and she'll call out, don't throw anything out! Well, like rubber, your sin hangs around you, you know. So there's a funny thing about that. And I think we look at children about this. Because if the family or parental expectation that you're going to do something wrong, then there is an expectation that you're going to do something wrong. And what happens? is that we all want to be good. That's that expectation. And fulfill it by doing something that they don't say don't do. Subconsciously. Consciously, I don't want to do it because I don't want to be bad. I want to be good. I want people to like me. Subconsciously, I will find myself doing what I'm not supposed to do. And then I'll say, what the fuck? You know, I didn't mean to do that. You know? So getting back to my little enigma, my wife, a friend of hers had, another thing. In this practice, you will find that your mind becomes more sensitive. So you become more sensitive to pain that you previously would just stomp right over, ignore, repress, and blame it on somebody else. So we become more sensitive to smaller things, particularly at our age, where we live in a world of smaller things. We're no longer, going out and getting huge career-changing jobs and relationships and all that. That's why this is the age for the spiritual path, because you can fine-tune on the subtle things that we missed in the first half. So we find that we're more sensitive. So anyway, as I said, this whole enigma came up again and began to get very, very irritating. And so the point that capped it, I think, was that a friend of ours had left some tea bags, a little box of tea bags, on the foyer where things collect, and I usually would. Well, that's been here 2 weeks. My wife leaves stuff out. I mean, she, we're opposite that way. I clean up and she leaves, So then I suspect she may put that there and see, how long is it going to be before it throws it out? I don't know if she does that. Anyway, it's missing. Where is the tea bag? Charlotte's coming over. I have no idea. Blank. Well, it was there. And she's getting really irritated now. So now we're in that situation where, like the car keys, are they under here? When you come, maybe I missed it. So you look under there 5 times. So going through that. And in these situations, I know I'm not going to find it because, And what happens is I discover, and this is important, is that we're both getting pain. And we both know, and the pain comes, we both know, because this is a recurring pattern that comes back when you least expect it. Everything is smooth, and the next thing you know is, where is that tea bag? And because it's a pattern, it's not just a random, once in a while, occurrence. The key in suffering, in detecting suffering, is the pattern. Random stuff happens, when you get nicked, whatever, you go on. But if it comes back, and it always comes back dressed in new, different clothes. This is important. The pattern comes back dressed in the clothes of the moment. So the conditions are different. The pattern is the same. It's like the sitcom. The plot theme is the same, but each show is different. Different situation, right? But the theme is there. It's not a brand new show. It's a theme. It's like a record. You play it again. Play it again, Sam. So when you play the enigma again, you know you got an enigma, first of all. All right, so last week we talked about rain, if you recall. So what I began to see was I was actually doing it. Okay. So first of all, I recognized that the enigma was back. Never did find the tea bags. Charlotte was coming over, and I went outside. It wasn't Charlotte. I couldn't find those tea bags you were supposed to pick up, so I may have thrown them out. Don't worry. But for my wife, it was, you threw out the tea bags. You know, so this, so it wasn't tea bags. It was the recurring cut. And I'm saying, I really don't know if I did it or not. So I can't say I'm sorry, honestly, because I am sorry. I didn't do it. But then I may have done it, and then I don't remember. And she says, I know he did it intentionally because the same thing happens over and over, but then I'm supposed to trust my husband and give him some space. Maybe he didn't do it. I don't know. Right? I don't know if I'm innocent or guilty. I don't know if he did it or not. Right? So what we're looking at here is this. And it's called ambiguity. I love this one. Or double bind, which means that both are guilty, innocent, and guilt. Right? Am I innocent or guilty? I don't know. Both have equal value. I can, I'm equally innocent. I mean, I honestly do not know. But I do know that there's a pattern, so I may have done it. But I have no intention because of my intent. I don't have the intention to cut my hurt my wife. So my intention is good. And yet, there's the pattern. You see? And she's caught in the same sense. So we have, this is me, you see. And this is her. So we're both caught on the horn. This is like the horn of dilemma. We're both caught on the, I don't know if this is true or that is true. And when this happens, we create we can see this kind of stuff happening in small things or big things. We see it in the news and the government, between the left and the right, which one is right, both of them are equal. When we get caught in this whirlpool, in mythology it was called one of the Odysseus went through the between the opposites of Sisyphus, Charybdis and Sisyphus, Scylla and Charybdis. So these are the famous opposites in mythology. The two cherubs at the Garden of Eden, guarding the Garden of Eden. Can you get back into paradise? Because you got to go through these cherubs. So all the action heroes in mythologies, they all have these fierce guards that come in pairs, gargoyles, pairs of opposites that Moses had to go through the part of the Red Sea, had to go through. So all of these things are in mythology, and they're also in our little everyday personal lives, but we don't recognize it because we don't know the laws. Nobody tells us about this. Everybody's just interested in the donut and not the whole. So the pain, is the pain in the loss of the tea, which is just tea, or is it in something else that we don't see? Is the pain in the people at the sofa factory, or is the pain in the uncertainty of not knowing what's going on? So the uncertainty is the pain. If I don't know that I'm, if I honestly do not know if I'm innocent or guilty, I am uncertain. I don't know. And I have to know. that's an imperative. We have to know what's real. We have to know. We have to be certain. Religion, the whole works is built on, I got to know. And then everybody picks out their donut and says, well, this is the one. You see. So, but I know. Then, of course, you want to make everybody know the same donut, and then everybody will be more confident of other people knowing something different. But anyway. But the pain is in the not knowing. Right? So what happens when we don't know? Death is what we don't know about, so we have a lot of anxiety about death. Are you disturbing us? Right? I mean, death is, there's no certainty there. Nobody comes back, and if they do, you know, just subjective experience or something. So we don't know about death. So there's a lot of uncertainty. And uncertainty is ambiguous, because you got this, and we don't know, and we have a loss of center when we have uncertainty. Now, why is a loss of center important? Those were people's way of creating a strategy to get out of the ambiguity of not knowing who I am. Loss of center means loss of who I am. You see? So when we're in this situation, I don't know who I am. It's kind of like the heart, you know, when people have a heart fibrillation and the heart loses its beat. Like that. And so the thing, you come, hit him in the chest, and it shocks the heart. So this is kind of like that fibrillation. Am I innocent? Guilty? I don't know. And that creates the vortex when you take the microphone and stick it next to an amplifier. Wah, 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 wah. Turn it off. Right? Or when you hit the bells, you go wah, 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 wah. That's an oscillation because it can't find the center. So when it finds the center, it stops. So when the Enigma machine found the center of the one constant in all the messages, which was Heil Hitler, I know Hitler got a laugh out of that. So when the thinking machine found that one constant, it found its center. Before it found its center, it was just thinking. And that's a psychosis. For people with psychosis, I don't know a thing, but I just don't understand it, is that it's a loss of center. So you just got thoughts coming around. There's no me. So there's no hole in the donut. So it's just like dough everywhere. Right? We're having a good time here today.
We should be meditating right now.
I used to, when I was in Cleveland, I used to hang out with some spiritualists. And the spiritualists, these folk people were, they were always looking for affirmations of what they were saying. So if they felt like they were saying something important on the phone, right? The universe affirms what I just said.
rub due to a difference in value that you would associate versus what your wife would associate?
No.
But, I mean, because...
Well, initially it was, because she valued the tea bags. And if I threw them out, I don't know. It was because I saw no value. There was just some box in there. Yeah, so initially...
Right.
Yeah, but that's not the cause of the suffering.
Well, I understand.
The pain.
Right.
Yeah, because that's really getting back to the impersonal and the personal. She had a personal relationship with that tea bag. Mm-hmm. She couldn't give it to a friend. I had an impersonal relationship. Just a piece of paper or something, you know. But she interprets that as he doesn't have a personal relationship with me. Because my things are my things. You throw out my thing, you throw out me. So you don't have a personal relationship with me. That's a sign that you don't have a personal relationship with me because you threw out my thing. And I, you know, until I had an impersonal relationship with the thing, and I'm sure I'm guilty of having an impersonal relationship with her too, otherwise this wouldn't occur. Anyway. Well, we're talking about how I went through this and discovered some keys to the enigma machine in my life, which has released a lot of energy and creativity. So we've gotten down to the point where ambiguity, either or, can't choose, which, creates an ambiguous situation where two things have equal value, and you can only have one. This is the key. You have to have, let there be one, there can only be one, and you have to choose. But, you know, but one of the Zen codes I love is that the master will say, this is an eraser, and if you say it's an eraser, you're wrong. This is not an eraser, and if you say it's not an eraser, you're wrong. Now choose, or I'm going to punish you. Which is it? Is it an eraser or not an eraser? So, but you have to choose, because you can only have one. You can't have two realities, or the mind splits and you're schizophrenic. Or have a nervous breakdown, which is what nervous breakdowns do. You know, I mean, we have to find a strategy to get out of the pain of this loss of center, whether it's through addiction, medication, suicide, violence, whatever. You know, but we have to get out because we cannot tolerate not being one. We can't tolerate not having a center of me. The tent pole has to be in the ground, or it won't hold up a tent. So if I lose the center, reality comes down. And that can't happen. But, so this is the, this ambiguity, it's like electricity is this. Electricity, magnetic field, positive and negative. Put them together and you get energy. Wow, 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 right? So you put the opposites together in a container, like a circuit, and you create energy, and you can use it. The other night, I'm trying to figure out what it was. I think it was last Thursday morning. I was having this dream, very powerful dream, with moving. My family, we were all moving somewhere. And I was awakened by a light going up. Big flash of light, sparks in the home. Boom, vibrated the house. Power went off. Then a light came on. Boom, boom, that big light. And I looked out the window and it was across the block. And a big light, sparks, boom, then the power goes on. Did that about four times, then the power went off and stayed. So I called it either moving. And it's also became a metaphor for me, because what happens in that situation is that you've got a circuit, a town is a circuit of lights. And if you have a short, you're going to get an overload of energy, and the circuit can't hold the new energy, so it blows. Or a house does that. You know, you stick in some, you've got four or five things on the circuit, and then you stick a coffee pot in newer iron, and you're going to trip the transmitter, and the circuit breaker used to be fuses, right? Because the circuit can't hold the energy, so you blow it, right? These things, when ambiguity is an energy generator, and when we lose the center, we can't contain energy. Our me is contains the energy, our psychic energy. So we create this me, and it contains psychic energy, like a circuit. But if we get into spiritual practice, what our heart's intention is to do this, and you all are here, is that we sense the limitations of the circuitry that we've been living in. The me, the personality, is always the same. I'm bored with it. You know, something more than life. Particularly when we get older, there's something more, and we're not comfortable living in the me that we built in the first half of life. And we found the limitations of it. Plain Eastwood said, a man should know his limitations. So when you know your limitations, and in other words, and then you get energy, this is what happens on the spiritual path, is that people start meditating and doing yoga and hang out with the teacher or start reading these spiritual practices that have energy now, and you take that and you start inviting that energy in, it's going to put pressure on your circuits. And a lot of people have become spiritual maniacs. You know, they get, you know, their circuit gets hyped up with all this energy, but it's still the same ego, only it's just expanding, and then it will finally blow. And the next thing you know, while they're in the papers for having sex with some of the students, or, you know, whatever. So the whole thing crashed, you know, because it couldn't contain the energy. But anyway, so we're trying to bring this back down and keep this thing on the ground. The pain comes from the loss of center. Now what happened in my experience, and this was the first time it happened, so this is why I noticed it was significant. Because I realized that this little tea bag had been causing so much pain, personal pain to my life, and I saw the helplessness I had been and was in trying to get out of it, because I could not say I'm innocent and forget about it, or I'm guilty and I'm sorry, because I didn't feel sorry. So that would not have stopped the enigma, unless you feel it. You can't feel it unless you do something wrong and say, I did. All right, so, but then this overwhelming weariness came over me. And it was an existential weariness of being caught in this enigma that just never seems to end. When you think it's gone, the next thing I know, it's where's that eraser? Well, back in it again. I have no idea. Did I throw it out? Well, you know, whatever. So it goes on and on and on. And I just had this overwhelming weariness, which comes when you realize you are absolutely stuck. You can't get out of this hole. But at the same time, you just sit with it. In other words, you don't go get drunk, you don't go take drugs, you don't go get divorced and go somewhere else who doesn't trust, you know, change the relationship, or go into depression because, oh, we're going to keep going. You just sit with it. And that's the whole thing about meditation, is that you just sit and you let this stuff come up, but you don't do anything to it. Because if you do something, you're the donut. You, in other words, this point, the donut, you're the center. You just sit in the center of the donut, you see, instead of trying to fix the donut, which is the enigma. So you don't try to fix it, you sit it. So, I really think that, I think that shifted something. Getting to the grill, not the iron grill. So the next day, Errol was over for breakfast, and I was going to grill some, I usually take a square skillet and grill some bacon on the deck. So there was a couple extra pieces of bacon. So I got out this iron, this cast iron griddle that Tilly had bought for the stove, because we had this little centerpiece in the stove to grill on. And I hadn't used it before. I hadn't used it in years. A long time, anyway. I don't think she really liked it. So I took it out to cook the bacon, Came back in, we ate the bacon, it was good, and then the full grease. So Tilly had gone, so I said, damn, I could put this thing in the dishwasher, and that'll clean that grease up. So I put that thing in the grease in the dishwasher and turned it on. Errol was there, she was watching. But Errol's good. You see, Errol is good because she doesn't say,
anything.
She gives me the space, trial and error. My wife would have said, don't put that in the dishwasher. I would never know, you see, not to do that on my own. Okay, what else should we do? All right, so I'll put it in. So I went out in the dishwasher, I could look at it, oh, and it stripped that thing clean. You know, it was smooth as a baby's behind, and just bare metal. It even started to rust. It was even rusty. So. But what was different between this and the tea bag was that I knew I had did. There was no question, you know, that I was innocent or wrong. Somebody else made me do it, but what, you know, I did it. So the next thing I wanted to do, more than anything else in the world, I wanted to buy another grill. And so, last Wednesday, we went to Costco. No, we went to Sears. And I went into Sears, and the guy said, I don't know if you got a grill or not. So I walked over to the shelf, and there was one little grill over there in the corner. And it was just right. It was kind of like Goldilocks, you know, just right. So I bought the grill, and I didn't even tell her, because really, I had not cleared all the rubbish out of this yet. I didn't want to, I felt a resistance again. I just put it out there in the porch, and then if I ever use it again, I got it in my grill. So if she ever says, where's the grill? I'm there's the grill. You know. So I really wasn't ready. I really hadn't moved through this whole thing far enough yet to be comfortable in opening up Pandora's box. Because a lot of times in a marriage, you know, when stuff builds up, there's a resistance. Because if you know, when you sit down and start talking, you don't know where it's going to go. Stuff's going to come out, you know, and be uncontrollable. You don't know, you know, somebody's crying, hugging, why'd you do that? And all of this, all the buried stuff comes out. So there's a lot of resistance in relationships to, you know, taking that step, you know, and because it's uncertain. You could lose your center. You know, you don't know what's going to happen. So we always keep our center where we know where it's going to, where we're certain. So if I'm holding back, I'm certain in that holding back. If I let go, I don't know where it's going to go, and I won't be certain. There might be pain, you see. So anyway, so I got the griddle, and didn't show her. I wrote this piece. I got it. Because a lot of times I write, when I write something out, I can see it. My writing tells me what I want to look at. Oh, there it is. So I didn't show it, I just had it. And yesterday, yeah, yesterday things had come, things that could, had moved along, so it had, I got my center back. Oh, this is interesting, just to show how simple this is. How every day. So yesterday, a friend of mine was over. Oh. She said, well, where is this griddle? I said, okay, well, it's because I was talking to her. We talked. She read the thing. And she's an English teacher and retired, so she combs my stuff if I ever give it to her with the flea comb. See, she found 2 fleas. But, so, oh, here's the griddle. Then she said, keep the box. I said, no, I threw it out. She kept the box, you know, because we have to cure the griddle. I said, well, I'll look it up on Google. And she said, well, you know, it may not be cured, but go ahead, put some oil on it and put it in the oven 300 degrees. So put some oil on it, wipe the character, put it in the oven. So we have this stove with these buttons on, it's not buttons, but they're little light, you know, press buttons. It's a loose one. She said, put it on, proceed, we have two ovens. Upper oven, yes, I saw that one. And then she said, put it on 300 degrees. So I punched in 300, ding, 300, ding, it wasn't taking it. And she said, well, press the oven button. So I'm looking. There's no oven button. I'm looking again. There's got to be an oven button because she said there's an oven button. Right? I'm looking. I'm going to wipe my eyes. Is it oven? I can't see. It's too dark in here. Turn the light on. Oven. Bake. Push the bake button. Bake. Boom. 300. Bake. Right? So, what happened? In that little teeny thing, my whole marriage. The dynamics here is that if I can't choose, or if I'm, I got instructions, she's the expert, I got the instructions, but there's something missing in the instructions, bake. So I can't find it, but I know it's there, but I can't find it. I'm caught up in here. I should know, I don't know. Where is it? Wow, 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 wow. My mind goes into a fibrillation, anxiety, loss of center, and when she comes in, there it is, bam! Saved at last. Right? So, she put an end to my ambivalence and restored my center. Right? But what happened was that my center was dependent upon her to maintain it. But she creates, you know, this is a subconscious pattern that I've discovered and revealing. And it's not, you know, we got divorced back in the 70s over this. We got remarried. So, I mean, it's not like, I mean, it's almost normal. Most people would say it is normal. The old games people play. We all go to marriages, we all play these little games, and we sit there and think it's silly. You just recognize it, right? You know it. But they're caught up in it. And you don't want to interfere with it, break it up, or they're really getting pissed at you.
And then.
Okay. So anyway, the dynamics of this little, the oven thing here, the incident, the oven, is that push the oven button. Well, she told me to push the oven button, but there was something missing from the instruction. And I was dependent upon her for the instruction, because I don't have the freedom to explore the kitchen. And you can't explore when you lose your center. when you are not sure about yourself, which is losing your center, you can't make leaps out of the basic facts. So the basic facts are the cold. The basic fact is she said the oven is there and I can't see it. But right there, big as daylight, is big. Now anybody who was not having a loss of center would just come over and hit big. It's easy as pie. But I could not see big. I could see it, but I didn't know what it is. Because I had no center. So when we get in these ambiguities, we can't make creative choices because we're locked into the law of that particular game. And we can't leap out and solve the problem from inside. We can't fix the donut from inside the donut. I can't get the oven thing to work when I'm inside the oven. Someone else outside of the oven can go, well, push my oven. But the relationship is that in our relationship is that she has been she has been the center of the marriage. She's been the tent pole, she's the strong teacher, the money comes in, she's in the community. I'm like a yo-yo running all over the place.
I have a question about that. They always say opposites attract, but would it be better to have a marriage where you're both the same, not the same, but similar, not so opposite, where you're more think alike, act alike?
Okay, good question. Here's what happens is that in a marriage, in relationship, let there be one. You can only have one leader in a relationship or a group or a business or a country. Otherwise, you have a civil war.
Right.
So in a relationship, doesn't matter what gender, in a relationship, it's got to have one. Most healthy marriages exchange leadership roles.
Right.
You know, I'm a leader in the kitchen, and you're a leader in the yard. You know, when you go fix the car, you know what to do. I'm fixing cooking. You know, I know what to do, whatever, you know, the job description. So everybody's a leader. Or one person gets stuck, and the other one helps. But the other one's not afraid to get stuck and have help. So you get this dance going back and forth, which is a normal way. The abnormal way is that we get competition for the leadership.
Oh, okay.
You know? So now you're in competition, and that's what happened with us, pretty much, in a very small way, is that this particular situation here is a deferment of the center to her. But she created the loss of center by giving the wrong instructions, which created my need for the savior. So we're playing a relationship game where each needs the other. I need to be saved. She likes to save. So we create the conditions where I need to be saved, and she can do the saving. So she creates the condition where I need to be saved from the loss of center in the wah-wah-wah by giving a slight error in the code. Press the oven button. In the code that writes computers, if there's one little comma off, the whole thing will work. See? So the code has to be perfect. If there's a mistake in it, intentional or otherwise, the system has to wobble in it, and you lose your center. Then somebody has to come in and fix it. Save me. This is the whole story of religion right there. So religion creates the need to be saved and then provides the savior. Salesmen do it, you know. They'll create the need for show you the need for the vacuum cleaner and then sell you the vacuum cleaner to solve the tension that the dirt on the floor created. Create the pain and then give them. Create the pain and then provide the.
Mm-hmm.
Because it binds them together.
Yeah.
And you need me.
Well, I was thinking
and then guilt comes in here too.
Yeah, I was thinking of the Clutter family. I'm thinking of a couple that they both have no problem with clutter. They have clutter everywhere. They have piles of stuff everywhere. Floor to ceiling, it doesn't bother either one of them.
Right.
Because they're more, they think a lot, they don't.
Yeah.
So.
Well, that's finding a center. They're both.
Yeah, they're both leaders.
Yeah. With us, you see, one, her different view of space is that my view of good space would be this would be clean, and hers would be a good place to store stuff.
Oh, yes.
Because I want to get around to it. So, you know, so we're in a lot of, you get a lot of round to it's all over the place. And, so this creates a dynamic, you see, which we've always tried to find balance in. We've been successful pretty much. We have a big round table in our office lying down the middle. And her, she has a pile of stuff on her side, and my side is clean.
That's what I'm saying.
If she leaves anything on this side, I just put it over there.
Wouldn't it be more harmonious if we were both alike? I mean, or
it'd be hell.
That would be hell if you wouldn't have that give and take or whatever.
No,
you mean if he was living with another person like him?
That would be the conflict for the, you know, see, this thing is a dysfunctional way of settling the problem of let there be one. But it is a compromise, it is a strategy where one hand doesn't know what the other one is doing. So this hand will come by, order, we'll bring order to the house, you know, so this will be better than that, you see. Bring order, that's a good intention. And she, she likes the order. I mean, she likes me coming up. But she doesn't like to go in the house where you have to wade through the stuff, you see. Which is what the house would look like if her value system was without a check. So my check, you see checks and balances, my check is to clean, and hers is to leave stuff out where she can get to it. She has a lot of projects, a book here, and a puzzle here, and she does a lot of gift cards and stack of projects there and stuff here. You know, and it's all everywhere she sits, there's a little pile of stuff. It's fun, really. I mean, you know, we've been married 50 some years, so
he's still working it out.
Yeah, it's a working relationship. Yeah,
she has a great sense of humor, by the way.
She does?
Yes.
That's good.
Oh, yeah. I mean, she's a great lover. I don't talk about, you know, stuff like this. But, she's the reason I'm standing here today. because if she had the tent pole, had been steady, the string would have cut to my yo-yo and I'd be off rolling in space somewhere.
She grounded you.
There's nothing worse than a yo-yo without a string.
Amen.
So whenever I got far out in my psychosis or my induced schizophrenia, which I told you the spiritual path was.
Yes.
In other words, you go ahead and say, all right, I'm going to invite madness, you know, and just see, you know, but it's going to be in a control situation so that I don't go there. So you need it so that her center, firm ground, enabled me to explore my spiritual life and still stay together. Mm-hmm. So anyway, what we've come up with, today, is that we've talked about the, so I want you to really, you know, look about it, you know, during the week, this is for y'all's inquiry, you know, because it's all in us and other people around us, everything is interrelated, everything has a logic to it, but we don't understand the logic of consciousness, which is what we're talking about. And when you understand the logic of our own consciousness, you are liberated from the enigmas or games that are buried in our psyche and keep coming up, you know, like fish to feed. And these circuits of games or opposites, this kind of thing here, contain energy. And this is free energy of my consciousness that is trapped in little buried zombies. What do you want to call them? Movies are full of this. You know, something buried down there is going to come up. Jaws, stuff coming up out of the ocean. Stuff buried in our unconscious that if we don't allow to come up and see through, it saps our energy and we begin to, and the body begins to have physical side effects. We're tired, we're bored, we're depressed. All of these symptoms are from basically a loss of psychic energy or love energy or whatever that is all tied up in these uninvestigated circuits that keep coming back. And each time they come back, they draw energy, because they take energy to run. It takes a lot of energy to run these little, I mean, this is not just a thought thing, I mean, it's people doing this. I mean, you know, it's physical, it takes energy to run these bodies around and make them do this.
Every week, I feel like you are telling the story of my life. Even though I'm living the monastic
life. Yes.
There's always something going on. But you go to Costco. Did you see the big wooden gazebo they had for sale?
I probably saw it. I didn't look at it close.
I bought it.
Oh.
And I had my brother, my son, and a friend. Uh-huh. I arranged them all to be in the same place, same time, last Saturday. My job was to watch the kids. And so I took the kids to the other, in a lake community, you know, took the kids to the beach. I came home. They were putting holes where they weren't supposed to. They weren't following the instructions.
The Costco people or your family?
My family.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's right. Costco's not put together.
I'm sorry?
Costco is good put together. You do.
That's right. And there was a video that you could watch.
Right.
About how to put it together. And so I was trying to get all three of them, while they were eating lunch, to come in and watch that video. And his brother stayed outside. And finally, I yelled at him like I would have when I was a child. And I said, Randy!
Took you right back.
Took him right back. And he got up in the kitchen. He said, you're bossy. But I just wanted them. My son was doing everything right, and they were improvising holes and stuff. And my brother refused to watch the video. So, there you go. Now the roof has to be redone.
Right.
The roof wasn't done.
Well, you know, what I pointed out was that
but I gave it up because of you. I went on the front porch.
Oh.
I'm giving this up.
Okay.
Because it was really, after you said I was bossy, I was like,
ooh. Okay. Well, that, you know, you can see if that has, that you're talking about family patterns here. Family patterns are cyclical. You know, they repeat themselves, you know, and so, and they can go very deep, you know. And family patterns are what we know.
Right.
So, there's an inertia for them to reoccur in relationships, because that organizes the relationships. Everybody knows their part. You're the bossy one, they're the stupid one, you know, whatever the game is, you know. It's like we have roles.
Yeah, so, I saw it, because my son was the part.
Right.
He told me later everything went on.
Yeah.
And he was so hopeless to stop it from happening. He felt so bad.
Yeah, so he's caught in now, so he's caught it.
He was caught, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I keep telling him not to worry about it, or get it right. But he felt awful.
Yeah, because you get caught, like, I should know what to do, but I don't know what to do.
Right.
I should stop him, but I don't know how.
And
then you go back and forth. So it's paralyzing. And the pain, like I said, is the loss of center, which is a feeling of helplessness. feel helpless, that means that you don't know what to do. You should know, but you don't. And then you worry about being helpless. And then you worry about worrying about being helpless. And then you worry about worrying about worrying about being helpless. And wah, 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 wah.
And you worry about offending his uncle and offending our friend. And that he knew it was all being done wrong.
So the other aspect here is this, is that when you lose center, somebody has to be blamed. It has to be a cause. There's the cause to everything.
I take full responsibility.
See what I mean? But, I mean, from the inside.
I mean,
from inside of him. You know, so this is a subjective view, not your view of him, but his view from inside out.
Right.
He's lost center. Painful.
It was painful.
Somebody or something has to be blamed. Who is it?
Jane wasn't blamed.
So, yeah, well, wait a minute now. So what, you've got to blame, there has to be a cause. Because you want to get rid of the loss of center. And you can only get rid of it if you remove the cause. So who is the cause for the loss of center? Well, then that's going to go either way. Either you're the cause or that's the cause. Or the situation is, or the boss did it, or the mother did it, or something, or I'm there. So if the finger turns in, then you move to self-blame, right? And you end up in depression. I'm no good, I'm worthless. See, there's a self-worth problem. And then that creates the impetus to create that situation another day, so you still experience the same pattern because now you know it. And to do otherwise would be uncertain and very scary. So then we stick with what we know, even though it is extremely painful, because we know it. Uncertainty is more painful. Uncertainty would be the end of the problem. So we can't even find the end of the situation because we don't know what it is, and that's the unknown. And we don't want to go there because we have to stick with what we know, and that's what pain. So, it's a perfect trap. I mean, it's the logic of it is beautiful.
It's two people that didn't want to read directions.
Yeah, right. I think we're good to stop there. Okay. We're good. Thank you so much.
Thank you.